Thank you very much, Ursula. So in the next few minutes, I really would like just to walk you through how we are trying to incorporate the patient perspective into our research in inflammatory arthritis. So this is how a standard workflow for clinical and translational research look like. So it all starts from the lab where the researcher can have an intuition and make a new discovery, for example, a new therapeutical target. And if this can be translated into human, it will go into clinical trial when patients are recruited throughout different phases of clinical trial. And if the clinical trial results successful, then this will be translated to a wider community and could benefit a major number of people. So this is very successful strategy, but the patients are really all involved once the idea has already been developed and is already being conceptualized in the lab. So the type of research we are trying to do is what we call public and patient involvement in research, which, as the name suggests, requires the involvement of the patient, the engagement between the patient and the researcher, and obviously the participation of the patient into our research. In this way, the patients are really involved from the beginning of the research, so involving the design, in the planning, in the research, and then throughout the different phases of the research itself. So really, we can create an engagement, a constant engagement between patient and researcher, which could be very successful. So this is how a patient-focused research looks like. So a patient goes to his consultant, and if I agree to participate in our study, he can ask to donate blood, and in some cases also biopsy. This is actually also useful sometimes in the clinical setting because it allows the clinician to discriminate between, for instance, rheumatoid arthritis and psoriatic arthritis, for instance. So this sample goes back to the lab where the researcher will study them truly and could investigate better the inflammatory state of this disease and could make a new discovery, which could eventually benefit the patient itself. So we have this loop between patient, clinician, and researcher, which could be very good for all the parties. So we have learned today that lifestyle is really important in the inflammatory state, and this applies, of course, also for inflammatory arthritis. So we are trying to incorporate this into our research. So at the moment, when we recruit new patients at the consultation stage, we ask them to fill additional information, such as their sleep pattern, how many hours a day they sleep per day, biometrical lifestyle like weight, BMI, smoking habits, how often the patient exercise, the anxiety score, and ultimately also the socioeconomic. In particular, we are getting the educational status and the salary scale. Actually, this last point, it's very important because it came out from our survey, which Mary presented earlier, that some patients cannot afford expensive medication. So we want to try to investigate this more in detail. Why is this important? I guess today we have really learned that a good lifestyle is important to balance your inflammatory state and to control your disease. So we want to understand how the lack of sleep, an unbalanced diet, or also stress, which could be physiological or psychological, could impact and contribute to the inflammatory state in inflammatory arthritis. So one of our study is focused on predicting responder to a therapy versus the non-responder. So we are recruiting inflammatory arthritis patient before they start a new treatment. So we are collecting blood from this patient and we are analyzed for different markers of inflammation. We then collect again the blood once the patient starts a new treatment, and we then stratify the patient between the responder versus the non-responder. So what we want to understand is there a difference in the marker of inflammation between the responder and the non-responder? And does the lifestyle could influence the response to a specific therapy? We are also introducing sleep, this effect on disease activity and response by recruiting health subject as control and inflammatory arthritis in patient, both male and female. And we're going to collect blood in different time throughout the day to understand how does the sleep influence the activation of immune cells and inflammatory arthritis, bearing in mind also possible gender bias into this data, and also how does the lack of sleep could correlate with the disease activity. We're also introducing the biometric lifestyle in our study. So as I mentioned, we are collecting different parameters, including height, weight, BMI, hip circumference, waist circumference, and smoking habit. Again, we are recruiting RT control and inflammatory arthritis in patients, and we want to understand how does the lifestyle correlate with disease activity. But also, should the patient decide to bring a change in their lifestyle, we want to understand how altering this lifestyle, for instance, quit smoking or start a balancing diet, if this could lead to a better prognosis. Just to give you a small example of why this is important, I'm going to show you a small data that we've collected last three years, in which we have measured the hip and the waist circumference and correlated with the inflammatory state within the joint. So here in the top, we have a joint which has been visualized with the small camera within the knee. And here we can see there is very low inflammation, which was associated with the low hip and waist circumference. But then when the patient were with high hip and waist circumference, we can clearly see that there is a much more marked inflammation within the joint, suggesting really that the weight could impact the inflammatory state at the site of inflammation. One of the studies we are carrying in our lab involved rheumatoid arthritis in patients, and we are trying to understand the prediction of this disease progression. So we have learned that rheumatoid arthritis require a genetic and environmental insult, which then will lead to the clinical onset of the disease and the rheumatoid arthritis. So it has been shown that 70% of patients with the rheumatoid arthritis produce autoantibody, like this ACPA antibody. And actually this can be present even before the clinical onset of the disease. So we have identified a cohort of subjects, which we call arthralgia, which are positive for the autoantibody, but they present no inflammation and they still don't have any clinical manifestation of the disease. A recent study has shown that between 30 to 70% of these subjects will eventually develop rheumatoid arthritis. So we obviously want to always understand how we can prevent this progression. This is just an example of the kind of study we are carrying. So in this case, we isolate from the blood a particular immune cells, which is called monocyte, and we want to look for a key marker of inflammation called TNF-alpha. And this is really important because one of the most successful strategies in managing the disease is actually therapy that block this mediator. So here we have in black, healthy subject, in green, arthralgia, in RA confirms a case of rheumatoid arthritis. And as we can see, the arthralgia cohort already produce more TNF-alpha than the healthy subject. And they are somehow in between the healthy subject and the confirmed RA cases. So before the onset of the disease, this cohort of arthralgia subject have cells that are already are hyperinflammatory. But we also observe that these cells require also more energy. As we can see here by looking at this marker of energy of the cells, which is called GLUT1. And also in this case, the arthralgia cohort really had higher amount of GLUT1. And it's again in between the healthy subject and the RA confirmed case. So can we prevent arthralgia subject to develop into RA? It's one of our line of the research. But also we want to understand whether the lifestyle can influence this switch from arthralgia to confirmed RA. So just to summarize, our patient research started with this survey that was early present from Mary, which really highlighted that there are some unmet answers from the patient, which we tried to address, organize a national workshop throughout Ireland, which really tried to empower the knowledge of the patient of their disease. From the feedback from this workshop, we have organized today's symposium, which I hope really could empower you on understanding better how sleep, diet, and exercise can really influence the inflammatory state of the disease. We are continuing our dissemination by doing video, which could explain better the disease to the patient. And we obviously want to enroll more patients into our focus research. So in this way, we can have a better understanding of the disease and lead to new potential strategy in the treatment of the disease. So this focus research, patient-focused research, can really work at its best and could be beneficial from clinician, from patient, and from researcher altogether. So if you're interested to know how you can enroll to our research, I now leave the floor to Professor Fearon, which will explain to you better how this can be achieved.
All right, well, there's only two more slides and I'm going to finish off. And I thank all the patients for attending the symposium today and all our speakers. But just to say that all of these studies are now incorporating lifestyle choices of patients, such as diet, sleep and exercise. And if you want to learn about the current studies or future studies where we might be recruiting patients after COVID, you can go to our websites up here, both for molecular rheumatology and for CARD. And we will have a section on our sites which will talk about our current studies and recruiting patients for future studies if you want to get involved. But that's really only two sites, and there are an awful lot more sites and an awful lot more units nationally that are doing fantastic research across the country. So I really would encourage patients to engage with the clinical teams and try and get involved in research. And I really want to highlight here Arthritis Ireland, which won't disseminate all of the ongoing research within Ireland, but also they're leading the Arthritis Research Coalition. And this is a national approach to doing research in specific patient cohorts so we can come up with better prognostic and diagnostic markers for patients and also better therapy. But we need it as a national approach. So basically, we will be recruiting through this national approach inflammatory arthritis patients, patients with vasculitis and connective tissue diseases, and patients with gout and osteoarthritis. And this is, you know, particularly for the inflammatory arthritis and the connective tissue, this is adults and children. And so basically there are a number of units so far that have ethics approval for this, which is on the, I think it's going to be on the Arthritis Ireland website. But basically we will be collecting clinical demographics on patients and following their progress. But in this, at the same time, we will be collecting biosamples. And in the lab, then we can look at immune, genetic and omic changes. And with everybody working together, we hopefully will come up with better prognostic markers, diagnostic markers and therapies for response to therapy. And the only thing I really need to emphasize here is that we can't do this work alone. And I really emphasize there are three partners in this. There's the clinical team, there's the scientific team, but most importantly, it's you, the patients, because maybe you don't know, but any diagnostic markers that we use in the routine labs or any therapies that any of you are on, the only reason we have those therapies is because you as patients got involved in preclinical trials and also got involved in clinical trials. So if we want to improve treatment strategies for patients, we need all of us to work together. So with that, I'd like to thank all the patients who were involved in our surveys, our workshops, who basically directed this symposium, and all the patients that have attended today and asked the questions. I really want to thank our speakers who really gave amazing talks. And I think that, you know, the information is what patients wanted. And finally, I'd like to thank the HRB who funded this project. And finally, I'd like to thank the people that have helped me organize this meeting, and particularly within my own group is Viviana, Mary, Siobhan, who I couldn't do without, and of course, Megan. And from the Arthritis Ireland side, I'd really like to thank Grania, Brian Lynch, and, you know, last but definitely not least, Bronwyn Marr. So I'd like to thank everybody. And if patients have any questions, as I said, you can go onto our website, the CARD website, our Arthritis Ireland website. And all of these talks have been recorded and they're also going to be put online as well. So thanks very much to everybody.